I don't know any jokes. No, they're all off color.
Man, oh man, I just interviewed Fee Waybill. Oh my God, I'm so excited. I can't wait for you to hear this. Probably my most favorite frontman of all time and has stories for days. So let's get right to it. This is Fee Waybill on the Rockstar Superhero Podcast. Step right up and don't be shy. Well, are you prepared for a fawning of which the likes you haven't experienced in some time? I mean, at least from a guy.
Sure. Go, Ben. I'm ready.
Well, before we get to why we're on the call, I'd love to hear about your early days in Arizona and what a young Fee was doing with his life before he discovered high heels and a powerful sense of irony.
Oh, gosh. I it was a dream, you know, to be in a band. It was a dream. Yeah. And my mother was a singer. And before she got married in Omaha, Nebraska, my mother sang with big bands. She was like the go-to singer in Omaha. When she sang with Duke Ellington once,
wow,
when they would come to town. And so she was a great singer, and we always had music in the house. As I was growing up, we always had music. We were always playing records. You know, we were always singing, and you know, she loved the Broadway musical soundtrack albums. And so we had, you know, Oklahoma and Carousel and Music Man and Sound of Music and every Broadway musical that you can imagine, we had the record. And we had, you know, West Side Story was one of my huge favorite. I loved West Side Story.
Oh, yeah.
And so we were always, you know, I was always singing. And When I went to high school, the Beatles came out, and oh my God, I lost it.
Yeah.
You know, I wanted to grow my hair. I wanted to be in a band, and then Jimi Hendrix, and I was just crazed for music the whole time. And, I went to Scottsdale High, and we had, and I kind of started there. We had a gigantic theater arts department, a huge building just for theater arts. And we had, you know, singing rooms, and we had rooms to build sets in. And we had this giant auditorium that was about 2,500 seats, you know, just for the theater arts. And every year we would do plays, and we had, you know, we would do a couple of musicals, and I did Music Man, and I did, you know, Oklahoma, and I did Little Abner, and I did all these plays as I was going through high school, and also dramas. Usually we would do two musicals and one drama every year.
Mm.
And I did Cyrano de Bergerac.
Oh my God.
And so I was just, you know, ensconced. I loved it. I stayed after school every day, and we, you know, we practiced and we worked on sets and we rehearsed and we made our own costumes. And we had a singing group. It was called the Scottsdale Singers, and it was a group of about 40 kids. It was a varsity group, only juniors and seniors. And, you know, there was like 10 of each. 10 bass, 10 tenors, 10 altos, 10 sopranos.
Right.
So it was a group of about 40. And we had the director of the whole theater arts department was a guy named Joe Esley. And Joe Esley directed the plays, and he was the director of this singing group, the Scottsdale Singers. And, you know, and everybody wanted to be in the Scottsdale Singers, but you had to be really good. And they had like a freshman version of it, you know, that didn't do nearly as difficult material. I mean,
right.
we did Handel's Messiah.
Oh my God.
You know, and which is just ridiculous. It's an inch thick,
yeah,
the book,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
It's crazy.
It's the War and Peace of musicals.
Exactly. And we used to do that at Christmas every year. And so I desperately wanted to be in that group. And they had auditions, but the summer before my freshman year, they had auditions for the Scottsdale Singers and then also for the freshman group. And I, like I said, I loved West Side Story. So I auditioned and I sang West Side Story. I sang Maria.
Really?
A cappella, Maria. I just met a girl named Maria.
Yeah.
And I mean, I knew that song backwards and forwards, and I was a tenor. I could hit all the high notes. And I ended up getting into the Scottsdale Singers, and Joe Esley was there, and the other director for the freshman group. Joe was there, and the other director, his name was Debs Valentine. And I did my audition, and Debs came up to me and said, "Oh, you're good. We're gonna put you in the freshman group." And Joe Esley came walking up to him and he said, "No, he's going straight into the Scottsdale Singers."
Wow.
And so I was the first freshman to ever be let into the Scottsdale Singers. Yeah. And so, I mean, I loved it. I loved singing. I used to go around singing Beatles songs all the time. And and we loved music. So my friends and I had three friends, we used to drive to LA from Scottsdale every weekend, not every weekend.
That's a long ways.
A number of times. Yeah. It's like 300 and 400 miles.
Yeah.
And I had a Volkswagen bus. So we would pile into this little, not bus, bug, a little original Volkswagen bug.
Yeah.
And we'd pile in and drive to LA and go see bands. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I went to the Avalon and I saw all these bands in LA, and, you know, we 67 Jimi Hendrix came out, and I just lost it completely with Jimi Hendrix.
Man.
And, in fact, I auditioned. My first audition for a band was, there was a band in Scottsdale. It was called the Mann Brothers. Hmm. It was John and Paul Mann. They were two brothers, and they had a band called the Mann Brothers. And they were looking for a lead singer. And I went, you know, they went to Scottsdale High, so I knew them. And so I got a hold of them, and I said, "I want to audition. I want to be in the band." And they went, "Okay." And they said, "Okay, well, what do you want to sing? We'll learn the song." And I said, "I want to sing Purple Haze by Jimi Hendrix." And they went, "No, no, no, we can't play that song. We can't, we don't do that kind of thing, that kind of music." I went, "Really?"
Yeah, that's not music.
We're kind of really mellow. And I kind of went, "Okay, well then I'm not coming. Sorry."
Yeah.
And so, anyway, I went to ASU, and my first year at ASU was 68, and I started doing theater there, only I didn't do musicals. I did just serious, you know, I did Macbeth and I did Chekhov and Ibsen and all these really serious.
Wow.
And then, kind of around January of 68, I freaked out. And I used to go to, I had all these hippie friends, and they had this place way out of town. They lived in this big trailer. And we used to go there on the weekend, and we'd sit around and we'd smoke pot all day long.
Sure.
And they had and they were also sick of society. They wanted to move out. And so they said, we're leaving. We're going to move out. We're going to, like Timothy Leary said, we're going to tune in, turn on, drop out.
Right.
And so about, And I said, okay, good. I'm down with that. You know, I wasn't digging going to college anyway. And so we did. We moved away, about 10 of us moved away to northern Arizona to a ghost town.
swear That's, to God. That is insane.
And it was called Jerome.
Okay.
And Jerome was a ghost town on the side of a mountain in the Verde Valley, up the hill from a little town called Cottonwood.
Okay.
Right on the Verde River. And Jerome was a mining town. They used to, a big mining company called Phelps Dodge had a copper mine there. And they, and it had been there for years and years and years. And when the mine ran out of copper, they sucked all the copper out of the entire mountain, and then they left. And they left this giant slag heap on the side of the mountain. And they also left all these little shacks, these miners' shacks,
right,
where all the miners would live. And they were little clapboard, you know, one room, tiny little things. And most of them didn't even have electricity. And they had a, you know, outdoor plumbing.
Mm-hmm.
So we moved to Jerome. And so when they left, everybody in town pretty much left. And the only people left there were like these old retired couples that had lived there forever. And so the whole town was just empty. And
except for these eight kids.
And all these hippies showed up, and we took over the miners' shacks.
Oh my God.
Everybody got their own shack. And we just sat around and smoked pot and did nothing pretty much.
Yeah.
And waited for somebody to drive up from Phoenix who had a bunch of pot we could smoke.
Sure.
So I got kind of really tired of it and being broke and being hungry. And my dad used to bring me up a 25-pound bag of brown rice, you know, because we were hippies and we only ate brown rice. And so then we would have a big dinner. I'd feed everybody brown rice.
Yeah.
And so I in my family, my dad was a writing instructor, and he was also a chief engineer of a big resort hotel. But we had horses. When I was a kid, I always had a horse. Hmm. And I had, you know, from like time I was like 6 or 7 years old, I had a horse, and my brother had a horse, and we used to ride around all the time. And we had a rental stable for a while, and we had a horse show ring where we would have horse shows. And so I knew how to ride. And I heard, when I was up in Jerome, I heard that there was a cattle rancher who was looking for cowpokes and looking for hands, you know, I went to this guy. His name was Dave Perkins, and he was a son of his father came from Texas with a herd of longhorns. He drove them all the way, and he homesteaded this area called Perkins, and they named the town after him, Perkinsville. And he had five sons, and they had so much land, he gave each of his son a ranch. And Dave was the youngest of the sons, and he was kind of progressive thinking, whereas everybody else was kind of a redneck cowboy.
Right.
And we had long hair, and I had really long hair. And so I went to Dave and I said, you know, I heard you're looking for hands. You know, I can ride. I'm a good rider. And, I'd like a job. And he said, okay, well, you know, and he paid me $50 a month.
That's a lot, wasn't it?
Well, it was at plus room and board.
Yeah.
So he fed me, he put me up, he gave me a horse and paid me $50 a month. Cool. And this was 68.
Yeah, you're 18, and, right?
Yeah. And and he had a Forest Service. He lived out, you know, he had a big ranch, and he had 250,000 acres of Forest Service land that he leased from the Forest Service. And
wow.
But there was so and I didn't know this at the beginning, you know, there was so little grass or food for a cow to eat on all this land that they limited the number of cows that he could run on this property. And not much, you know, it wasn't really fenced. There wasn't a lot of fences. But he could only have 150 cows on this 250,000 acres. So he would, you know, in the spring, he would bring the cows in and he'd have his bulls impregnate them all and then send them back out there in the wilderness. And then in the fall, round them up and bring the babies in and, you know, castrate them and
start over
and feed them and take them away from their mother. And it's like feed them up so that you could sell them to, you know, the feedlots and make hamburger out of them.
Yeah.
And so that's what I did for about a year. Gosh, for about a year or more, I rode the range with him and, and I was a cowboy and I loved it. I had such a great time. I had a sleeping bag on the back of my saddle and I'd ride out there and sleep in the desert. And during that time, that's how my whole world kind of changed because Roger Steen, mm-hmm. our current Tubes guitar player, mm-hmm. Roger and Prairie had a band in Arizona, a trio called the Red, White, and Blues Band.
Yeah.
When I was living in town, I used to go see them play all the time. There was a little club in Phoenix called the VIP. And I used to go there to watch them play. And I guess I went back to Phoenix or something to see my parents or to, I don't know why.
check in,
get some money.
Yeah.
And I told them, I said, you know, I live up in this, it's really cool up there. There's just nobody up there. It's a desert. It's really great. And there's a big creek running by and you can go swimming and it's really cool. And so they came up, they said, oh, okay, cool. And so they drove their equipment truck up and they had a gas generator and they drove their truck up and they set up their equipment in the desert and just played and plugged it all into the generator and they would just play to the desert.
Incredible.
To nothing. Just play to the wilderness.
Incredible.
And it was so cool. And, you know, there was maybe four of us watching them. There was a couple of people that I lived with in a little cabin.
Yeah.
And
the wolves.
It was so great. And then that's kind of how I, in the summer of 69, they decided to move to what happened was Prairie got a scholarship to San Francisco Art Institute. He was an artist.
Yeah.
And he got a scholarship and they decided that they're going to move to San Francisco because they don't want to break the band up because Prairie, just because he's, you know, he's going to go there, whether they want, you know, the band was coming or not. So I said, oh, let's move there. And so, they asked me to be the roadie.
That's
and
amazing.
We moved to San Francisco. I drove the truck. I set up the gear. I did the cooking. I was the doctor. I was also Dr. Fee.
Oh my God.
And that's kind of how I got out of town. And then what happened was, we're living in this little house in the Sunset District and, you know, doing these little gigs and with the band. And there was a bass player named David. And we had this little house and it was a two-story house. And on the bottom floor was the garage and on the second floor was the bedrooms. And so the band would set up their gear in the garage and practice and play in the garage. And the place was, you know, the walls were like paper thin.
Of course.
So we'd be playing down there and the whole neighborhood could hear us playing or hear them playing. And people used to stand around outside the garage door and listen and hang out. And we met this guy who was a pot dealer And his
all these drugs, man.
Right. His name was Spike.
Nice.
And Spike would come over and give us pot. And then he'd hang around and we'd let him hang around and listen to the band play. And so we all were smoking pot. And then the bass player guy who lived in the garage, like 10 feet from the rehearsal area, he just rather smoked pot all day long and decided he didn't want to practice anymore. And he was too stoned and he didn't want to play. And they got mad and there was fighting and so they kicked him out of the band. And so he left. And so then they tried to find another bass player. They put an ad in the Haight-Ashbury Free Press, you know, bass player needed.
Yeah.
So they auditioned a bunch of bass player guys and they didn't like any of them. They were playing original material. They weren't playing cover songs. They were playing songs that Roger had written.
Right.
And so in the meantime, they would rehearse with no bass player. And he was also the lead singer. So since I knew all the songs, I would go down and sing the lead and in the rehearsal. And so they ended up, another band from Phoenix ended up moving to San Francisco, Bill Spooner's band.
Yeah.
And Bill's band was called the Beans. And they were a quartet with Bill and Vince and Rick and Bob, the drummer.
Wow.
And Vince and Bob, who are no longer with us.
Yeah, yeah. Sad.
Yeah, and so we the problem was we had gigs, but no bass player. And they had a band, but no gigs.
Yeah.
And so they had a manager. We had a manager, you know, some high school kid who, you know, moved there with us. We had absolutely no idea of what management would be about. And so they got together and they said, well, why don't you guys join our band and we'll do your gigs? And so we went, oh, okay, because they were sick of trying to find a bass player. Rick was a great bass player.
Yeah.
And so now we're going to have two drummers,
yeah,
two guitar players, and bass and keyboards. And Bill's band already had roadies. They already had two guys who were roadies. And I kind of went, well, okay, well, what about me?
Yeah.
What about Fee? And they said, well, you can be the background singer. Okay. And because Roger told, he said, he's a pretty good singer. He can actually sing. So I said, well, yeah, I can sing harmony parts. I'll be a background singer. I'll sing harmony. And he went, okay, fine. I mean, it's not like anybody was getting paid.
Sure.
So it didn't matter how many guys were in the band, you know?
Sure.
And so I started singing as a background singer with them. And then I just, you know, I sang too loud was the problem. They kept saying, you sing too loud. What the fuck? You sing too loud. I went, well, okay, well, let me sing lead then.
Yeah.
Then you won't have to worry about it. I went, oh, okay. Okay.
I fine. Could see Bill you rolling sing. His eyes right now.
Yeah. Okay, fine. You sing lead then, you know. So that's, you know, that's how we all got started.
That's amazing. You know, I knew bits and pieces of that, Fee, but I've never heard that whole story. And it makes so much sense because,
yeah,
you know, as the Tubes evolved into the late 70s Tubes, especially when you had nine members and you had, you know, you had the two drummers again. It makes
right.
sense. You'd already trained yourself. But what I love about your story that's incredible and it stuck with you for the last 50 years is you had the DNA. You know, you had it from your mom. You
mm-hmm.
had the intelligence from your father. You had all these things that were sort of programmed into you. But you had this insane level of ambition and drive. And you just kept going. And, you know, a guy said to me a long time ago, if you ever want to have a job, you got to outwork the boss. And it seems to me that everything you're telling me is you're showing up because you were stoked and you wanted to be a part of it. But you, it's not that you wanted to lead. You just wanted to be in there and you knew you had to outwork everybody. I think that's true.
I think you're right. And it's always been that way, you know, as we got more and more popular, you know, and Kenny Ortega came and found us.
Right.
And, I immediately latched on to Kenny and I said, Kenny, you are brilliant and I will do whatever you need me to do. You just tell me. And, you know, well, I want you to wear these big shoes and I want you to do this and I want you to jump over this and I want you to, you know, learn to dance. And, I said, okay, I'm good. Let's go.
No, that's incredible. You know, I first discovered the Tubes in 79. I was 13 at the time, and I had a friend that was deeply dissatisfied with his family. And, you know, he would invite me over to his house. I'm a drummer. I've been playing since I was a little boy. And,
oh, really?
Yeah, and I'd come over to his house. In fact, Prairie is one of my major influences. His skill and ability to play for the song is incredible, you know. But, you know, I would go over to this guy's house, and you know, after playing Kansas Left Overture all the time, you know, you get a little burned out, you know, and this guy says to me, well, I have the solution to all your needs. And I'm thinking, oh, I don't know if I'm pissed off at life like you are, but, you know, whatever. So he pulls out your first LP and he drops the needle on White Punks on Dope. And he just sits there and watches me revel in the madness of it. And of course, because he's more than a bit of a malcontent, you know, he mouths with extreme prejudice the words, so fucking rich. And here I am, this 13-year-old kid, you know, having grown up in a church family, and hearing the F word was really rare, right? And so there's that funny little thing that happens where your brain goes, well, who doesn't want a little naughty in your life? You know, it was basically you guys and Ted Nugent. I just never really heard that, especially on a record, you know. And of course, this is before, you know, the stickers that would, you know, warn you of, you know, potential damage to your souls.
Right.
but it was a huge introduction for me. And after that, you know, I personally dove deep into the closet with the Tubes. You know, I bought everything you'd made up at that point, you know, which at the time I think was Remote Control. And, you know, a few years later, you guys really broke with, you know, Completion Backwards Principle. And yeah. I have to admit, I was kind of upset. And not because, you know, it wasn't that you had changed styles or you became really well produced or anything else. It was because you became well known. And this little eccentric group that I had taken to my heart. And I lived in the middle of nowhere, Washington State at the time. I mean, we're talking town of 900 people. So I felt like you were mine, you know?
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, this is common experience. This had to have occurred with a lot of your fan base. You know,
was just going to say that we had a lot of that kind of feedback because here we were, this weird cult band on A&M, you know, who did these weird albums and Herb and Jerry, A&M, you know, Herb Alpert, Jerry Moss, they loved us in the beginning because we were such a cult, weird cult band.
Yeah.
And their label was like, you know, the Carpenters
and Captain and
Tennille and all these super straight bands, you know, Supertramp, Head East, you know, all these, God, they were so straight.
Yeah.
And we made 5 records with them and then, you know, we never really broke out of that cult status. And finally they released us and they said, okay, well, you know, and we got lucky with going to Capitol Records because we had, you know, we tried everybody and nobody was really interested. And this guy at Capitol, his name was Bobby Columbi, and he used to be the drummer of Blood, Sweat, and Tears.
Oh,
speaking
yeah.
of drummers, and he said, "Okay, I'm going to sign you." Or they signed us for 3 albums, but one at a time. They said, "If you you need to reach the radio, you need to sell records.
Right.
And if you do, we'll give you another deal. And if you do that again, then we'll give you another deal." They started parading producers us.
Here it comes.
Rick Wakeman, they brought up Rick Wakeman as producer. Yeah. Weird. It was really weird.
Yeah.
And we didn't like him. And
too many capes.
Yeah. Yeah, it was very weird. And Jeff, I'm trying to remember Jeff, the guy's name. Jeff used to be in, I can't remember his name, Jeff. And he was like a producer that had like a weird reputation of being a CIA guy.
Oh, that's bizarre. Kind of like Chuck Barris, how he pretended to be a CIA guy.
Right. But this guy, I mean, this guy showed up in San Francisco and he had like a pistol under his jacket, you know?
So he's eccentric.
Yeah. And we kind of went, okay, no, sorry, Jeff. No, I don't think so. And then they sent up David Foster, and David Foster here is this kind of really straight Canadian guy.
Right.
He had never smoked pot, never took drugs. He didn't drink. He was just as straight as you could possibly be. And we thought, oh my God, we're so fucking weird, you know? And, you know, no way this guy's ever going to go for this. And, but then we sat down with him and like, you know, we started playing, he said, okay, play me some of your songs. And so we sat down. I think one of the first songs we played with him, was Amnesia.
Okay. Which is one of your best. Absolutely.
Yeah.
One of your best.
We played it for him and he went, okay. And he was sitting at the keyboard with Vince and he goes, yeah, well, what if you, put in this part or the whoa, whoa, whoa part. He added this part of it. And then what about this at the modulation? And we all were just standing there with our mouth hanging open.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
This guy's brilliant.
Yeah. He was producing.
This guy is not only a producer, but he's an arranger. He's a musician. Mm-hmm. He's incredible. And we latched onto him right away. Boy.
Yeah.
And like he said, during that first record, he said, well, you know, the record company's looking for a ballad because everybody's, you know, Journey had a big hit with a ballad and REO Speedwagon had a big hit with a ballad and we want a ballad. And I haven't heard any ballads. And Vince said, well, I've got this tune. And Vince started playing Don't Want to Wait Anymore. And Foz went, okay, that's it. And he sat down with Vince and then he went, okay, well then it has to pay off and it has to modulate here and the big finish and big chorus at the end. And I just went, well, I had written the lyrics for it. And I said, well, and I showed him the lyrics. He said, perfect. You're good.
Yeah.
And, so, I mean, the guy was amazing. And
Bill sang that, right?
Bill sang that. Yes.
So how did that happen?
That's a funny story. I had up to that point, I was pretty much singing most of the songs. I mean, Bill sang, you know, like on a remote control, he sang one song.
Right.
And then some of the other songs, some of the other albums, the one before that was a live album. And then,
right. He did the overtures and stuff like that while you were changing.
Right.
Clothes.
He did the overtures. He did Up From the Deep. He sang Up From the Deep and he sang, I can't remember what My Head Is My Only House maybe or something.
Yeah.
On
he didn't
now
sing
album.
Boy Crazy though, did he? That was you.
No,
was
no.
It?
I sang Boy
yeah,
Crazy.
That's what I thought.
But he wrote it. That was his song.
Okay.
And, but I, you know, the Don't Want to Wait was my baby because I wrote it. Vince and I wrote it and I love the song.
Yeah.
So I went into the studio first and I did a lead vocal for that song.
Mm.
And I thought I had a really great lead vocal. I did it. It was really good. And, we were in LA. I'm trying to remember what studio we were at. I can't remember. But Umberto, the engineer's guy's name was Umberto Gatica.
Yes.
And in fact, Umberto came up with the title for Talk to You Later because he used to always say, you know, we say, well, Umberto, why don't you try this? What about some echo here? What if we turn this upside to play it backwards? And he'd just kind of look at us and go, talk to you later. Okay. In other words, you're a fucking idiot.
That's
okay?
Great. That's great.
Don't
I love
talk
it.
To me. And, and I think part of it was, you know, after we were almost done with the record and I And Foz said, you know, the one thing we don't have is like a rock radio, up-tempo rock song.
Right.
And we had a couple of choices, and he goes, no, no. And he says, you know, he came to me and he said, you know, I know a guy who is a great rock writer here in LA. He's a studio guy, guitar player. His name's Steve Lukather. And he said, I want you and I and Steve to get together and try to write a rock song.
Yeah.
Okay. And we were at a little studio out in Panorama City in the Valley. And he said, I want to show up. You show up at 10 o'clock in the morning and you and me and Luke will write a tune and see what we come up with. And I did. And the band wasn't supposed to be, we were working 4 to midnight. Okay. That was our 8-hour shift. And 4 p.m. to midnight.
Yeah.
And so I showed up at 10 and Luke shows up and Foz goes, well, you know, we need this kind of up-tempo tune. And, you know, and Luke was kind of familiar with our material and he came up with the lick for Talk to You Later in about 10 seconds.
Yeah, that guy's literally badass.
He sat down and went, okay, dun, 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 and went, oh, and Foz went, okay, there you go. And we record, I sat there with my lyrics, my Mead notebook, and started writing lyrics. And, you know, and Foz kind of, the melody is kind of dun, 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 dun. And I went, oh, I'll talk to you later. And it's fucking Umberto's line.
Yeah.
And so we wrote that song in about 4 hours.
Good God.
And we recorded it immediately. We had Luke play guitar and the rhythm. And I sang all the background vocals and all the lead vocals. And Foz, I think there's a little bit of keyboard, not much. And we did the whole thing. And then at about 2 o'clock, we called Prairie up and we said, Prairie, come to the studio. So Prairie came in, we put the drum track on.
Yeah.
So by the time the band shows up at 4 o'clock, this whole song is done.
So you did all the background vocals on that? I mean, it makes sense because it's such a tight, you know, a mm-hmm. tight tone, yeah. If that makes sense, right? It's all the same yeah. timbre. It makes complete right. sense. Wow, wow. Okay, that is yeah. so amazing.
And so I have to say, you know, so the band shows up and they're, you know, and we're thinking, oh my God, this is such a great song. They're going to be thrilled.
Yeah.
And they kind of went, yeah, okay. Yeah, they were not thrilled.
Oh.
And they were not thrilled. And understandably, you know, we didn't tell them. We did it all behind their back, really. And, you know, they're going, oh, man, I don't know.
Sure.
You know, and be kind of prideful. And, you know, I kind of understand it. I really understand it. And so they were, and we're so enthusiastic. And I'm over the top, you know, and I'm talking about how great it is, and everyone, yeah, right, okay,
yeah. Well, it's not Attack of the 50-Foot Woman, though, you know what I mean? I think there is a sort of twin, almost like a Twin Peaks vibe to the Tubes. You guys were so yeah. subversive, and then all of a sudden, you have this super clean pop rock sensibility, you know, super yeah. glossy. I dug it. I mean, Mr. Hate, oh my Lord.
Yeah.
Like that. Yeah. First of all, that album is incredible. But, and I'm sorry for interrupting you, but holy shit. I mean, that album is top to bottom. You know, again, yeah. as a drummer, I would go home from school and I'd put that on and
yeah.
I would stare at the you know, the back cover of the LP and look at the photos of you guys and just play drums along with the entire record. And it was a blast.
Yeah.
It was just a blast from top to bottom.
Yeah. It was, I think it was the best record we ever made. I mean, it wasn't the biggest seller, but that first record with Foster, because he had never done a rock album before. He had just come from
yeah.
doing Boogie Wonderland with yeah. Earth, Wind, and Fire.
Yeah.
So he didn't know rock, and he didn't have any preconceived idea about it.
Yeah.
And we dug the fact that he was kind of an R&B guy because we loved that also. And so the molding, the melding of it just. So anyway, what happened was, so Bill's kind of pissed off.
Yeah.
Okay. And he hasn't got to sing any songs on the record. And so they're in the studio late at night and they're mixing. Okay. And the record is done and we're into mixing. And Bill shows up at the studio late and there's nobody there but Foz and Umberto. And he shows up and he's shit-faced. Mm. He's, you know, been drinking all night. He's pissed off, you know.
he's Don Henley of your band.
Right. Right. And he says, man, this sucks, man. I didn't get to sing a single song on the whole record. And oh, fuck, And Foz and Umberto go, well, you know, they didn't want to argue with him. They didn't want to fight him. They just said, well, you want to sing something? What do you want to sing? We'll put up a mic and you go out and sing it. He goes, okay. And they said, well, what do you want to sing? He goes, I want to sing Don't Want to Wait Anymore. And they went, okay. And
yeah, you better kill it.
And that's exactly what he did. He went out there completely zonked out and just killed it.
Yeah. It's an incredible song.
He sang that song like his throat was going to explode. And oh my God, I couldn't fucking believe it.
Yeah.
Umberto and Dave just were, you know, awestruck, and they just went, oh my God. And they, you know, recorded the whole thing. And, and then Bill, you know, slunk off into the night somewhere in LA. And the next morning we come to the studio to see how it's going, see with the mix, the progress on the mixing is. And David says, dude, you know, I got to tell you. And he told me what happened. He said, Bill came in last night, man. And he goes, this is ridiculous. And I went, oh, dude, what do you mean, man? That was my song. You know, I am blah, blah, blah. What about my vocal? What about? And I'm fucking whining, you know? And
it's like, doing what's best. Do what's best.
Yeah. And so he said, well, just listen to it. You just listen to the track and you tell me.
Yeah.
And they played it for me and I just kind of went, oh, fuck.
Yeah.
I said, okay. Okay, I can't. This is ridiculous. You have to use this. You have to use this vocal because, you know, this just blew me off the table, and so anyway, that's how that happened. And then, you know, he used to, and then we did the video, and then you know he sang it in the video, and it's still. I mean, it's. It's I sing it now because, you know, Bill's not in our band anymore.
Yeah.
And it's such a great song. And I love, it's my most favorite song to sing. And yeah. If I sang it like he sang it and that blood curdling, I wouldn't get another song out. That would be the end of my night.
Yeah.
You know?
That song's a painful song. I mean, when you listen to it, the way he sings, it's so plaintive and so broken.
I know.
Now your story makes complete sense. I mean, I can imagine him just standing there with one eye closed, just gasping to get through it and saying, you know what, screw you guys. Check this shit out. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I'm going to destroy.
Yeah.
That's amazing. You know, how much time do we have? Do you mind if I ask? I heard we had an hour, but I mean...
On. We have an hour. What is it now?
Well, I got 15 minutes 12, left.
You got 15 minutes. Yeah.
Dude, I have so many questions. Okay. Well, look, let's do this. Let's do the two word thing here. Richard Marx. Two words.
Oh.
Richard Marx. Tell me a tiny, tiny bit about how you guys got connected, and then let's actually get into the conversation, you know, the whole purpose of today, which is your new project, Fee Waybill Rides Again, because it's awesome. And I'd love to hear more tube stories, and I could keep you all day, man, but if I don't, you know, your management's going to yell at me.
Yeah, okay. Talk about me for a while.
Yeah.
We met because of David Foster. We were in the studio in doing the Outside Inside album, and Richard, he lived in Chicago. Richard was the son of a jazz keyboard player named Dick Marx, and Dick was a very well respected jazz player around Chicago. And he also was the jingle writer. His dad wrote the Double Mint Gum jingle.
Good gravy.
And My Dog's Better Than Your Dog. My dog's Kennel Ration.
Yep.
He wrote all these great jingles. And so Richard, you know, learned to play keyboards. He started as a keyboard player and a singer, and would help his dad record all these jingles. And Richard wrote a song for Lionel Richie. And he got it placed on a Lionel Richie album back in 83. And he came to Chicago, to Los Angeles, to watch Lionel record his song. And while he was there, he asked Lionel if he could set it up for him to meet David Foster, because he was a big fan of David Foster. And Lionel said, well, yeah, he's down the street doing the tubes. And so Richard showed up at the studio one day when we were in the studio with Dave, and he just came in and sat down in the back of the room. And it's funny, because once again, Bill was trying to do a solo, a guitar solo, and having a hard time and frustrated and Foster is very, you know, he's such a perfectionist.
Sure.
And if you one little tiny bad, you know, note, and he got to do it again. And this was obviously before Pro Tools or anything. You couldn't fix anything. You had to go back and do the whole fucking thing again. You know, you couldn't fix it. You couldn't edit tape. You couldn't do anything like that. And so Bill was upset and he was frustrated, and we're in the studio listening to a take, and I'm there, and Foz and Umberto and Bill. And Bill, you know, turns around and he sees this strange kid sitting in the back of the room. And he goes, well, who the fuck is that? And get this kid out of here. I went, Bill, come on. He's just some kid. He's here to see Foster. You know, don't worry about this kid. Just go do your thing. Okay. Mm-hmm. And so he did. And, so at the end of the session, you know, Bill leaves and I'm there, you know, I don't know, listening to playback or something. And Richard gets to meet Dave Foster, and then he says, oh man, you know, I really, thanks a lot, you know, for saving my ass. Okay. And being kind. And I said, no, dude, it's okay. You know, it's no problem. You know, he shouldn't have been that bitchy. And
yeah.
So he goes, you know, would you consider writing a song with me? He goes, I'm a fan of the tubes and I kind of know your lyrics, and I think you're a great lyric writer, and would you write a song with me and, you know, write lyrics with it? And I went, okay, sure. And so I did. And so I wrote, the first song we ever wrote was a song on my first solo album called Who Loves Ya Baby.
Oh yeah.
The tagline of, you know, Kojak.
Yeah. Yep.
And, we said, well, let's write another song. And at that point, he was just writing songs for other people. And we wrote Living on the Edge of a Broken Heart by Vixen.
Yeah.
And I don't know. I think that went very high. Number one, maybe. I don't know.
Yeah, all over the world.
I don't remember. But anyway, and then he decided that he wanted to perform and to sing his own songs instead of hand them off to other people. And so we started writing songs for him. And we wrote the first Richard Marx album. And, you know, I had like three or four songs, lyrics on that album. And then the next album, I had three or four songs on the lyric. And then the next album. And then, you know, so we've been friends. We've been pretty much best friends. I'm like his big brother.
Yeah.
He didn't have any siblings, and we are so close. And even though I'm 15 years older than he is, which he never lets me forget, by the way, you're really old.
Yeah,
I know. And so we've been writing together for fucking 38 years or something. I don't know.
Yeah.
And now he lives here in L.A. or not in Malibu. He divorced his wife.
I heard. Cynthia, he met her through you, right? She was a dancer for the Tubes.
She was a dancer for the tubes, but she had left the band and was acting in LA, and he met her completely separate. We didn't have anything to do with it.
Oh, wow.
It was completely separate from the tubes. And I don't know how it all came down. She was doing Dirty Dancing or Flash Dance or something.
Yeah.
And they met somewhere. And but then I became the godfather to his children. And yeah. We were very close. And I used to go to Chicago all the time and hang out with him. In fact, that's how we wrote Faker, you know, getting back to Fee Waybill Rides Again. My second solo album, Don't Be Scared by These Hands, mm-hmm. Richard also helped with a guy named Bruce Geich from Nashville. And he was instrumental in that and writing and producing that. And then we always told, well, let's do another record, man. Let's do, you know, we said that for about, what, Don't Be Scared was 98. So for like the next 10 or 12 years, we were, oh, let's do another solo record. And okay, yeah, right. And we never got to it. And he was touring and I was touring and, you know, on and on and on. And but then every year we used to go on a boys trip, and I would go to Chicago, and the boys, they had, his dad had a cabin up in northern Wisconsin in a little town called Minocqua. And we would drive up to Minocqua with the boys and spend a week in the cabin. And we'd go fishing, and we'd go go-kart riding, and we'd go horseback riding, and we'd just do boys stuff and just hang out. And we did this for years and years and years. We did this for like 10 years in a row. And then the summer of 2013, I went to Chicago and the boys were older now. You know, Brandon was, he was born in 1990. So Brandon's like 23 and Lucas is 20 and Jesse is 18 or 17. And they didn't give a shit about going to Minocqua anymore. And they went, we're not going. Okay, forget about it. We're not going. And I went, oh, come on, what, you know? And we had tried to do other stuff. One summer we flew to Cody, Wyoming and did whitewater rafting. Yeah. And we were trying to do more, you know, more dangerous stuff. And they didn't want to go. And so Richard's going, well, let's go. He had a studio at the house in Chicago, or north of Chicago, in a town called Lake Forest. And he said, well, let's go write a song. You know, the boys are not interested. They're going out with their girlfriends. So let's go write a song. And so we went and we wrote Faker.
Wow.
And he said, you know, I think it's time. Let's do your record. I want to do a guitar oriented, a guitar heavy rock record.
Yeah.
Just a rock record, nothing weird. And so I said, okay, let's do it. And so right around that period of time, we wrote four songs. We wrote Faker, How Dare You, Promised Land, and Woulda, Coulda, Shoulda.
Okay.
We wrote those four songs, and we kind of got them in the can. And then the whole thing, and then I guess it pretty much everything kind of fell apart for a while. And Richard got divorced, and he moved to California, and the tubes were on tour constantly, and we just never got back to it for about 3 or 4 years. We never, and finally in the summer of 2019, you know, everything had kind of calmed down. Richard was living in Malibu, married Daisy Fuentes. He was happy. He was, you know, everything was kind of, you know, smooth again.
Yeah.
And he said, let's go in the studio. Let's find some songs and finish this off. And so I said, okay, let's do it. And so we did, we drug up, there was one song, Say Goodbye, was a song I had written with him. He never did it. I loved the song. And I said, I want to do this song. So take your vocal off. This song was already done.
Oh, wow.
Just ripped your vocal off, put mine on. And do some more background vocals and maybe a guitar or something.
Yeah.
And then there was another song that he had written with, he had written a song with Chad Kroeger of Nickelback for Daughtry, and they submitted it to Daughtry, the Still You on the Inside.
Okay.
And I loved that song, and he sent me the song, and I went, oh, my God. And Chad's vocal on the demo was so fucking great.
Yeah.
And I just went, oh, my God. And I played it again and again. I put it on my iTunes list, and I played it again and again. And finally, and he didn't do the song. And I said, when we were looking for songs, I said, I want to do Still You on the Inside.
Yeah.
And I said, I don't think there's no way I'm going to beat Chad's vocal, but I'll do my thing.
Sure.
And so we did that. And I didn't have anything to do with that. That's the only song on the record I didn't have any writing credit on.
Oh, man. I loved it. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead. Sorry.
I was going to say, it's my favorite song because, you know, those other songs I've listened to 1,000 times.
And, sure.
But then there was another song. What was the song we couldn't find? Man of the World. He sent me this track and he goes, we did this track a long time ago and I can't remember what the title was or what. I don't know if you ever wrote lyrics for it. See if you can figure out what it is. And it was just a track, no vocal. And with like a la-la melody line. That's kind of what he sends me a song and he goes, la 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 la, and not with no words, right?
Yeah.
And I don't remember the song and I said, well, okay. And I have a folder on my computer of lyrics and all of the lyrics I've written are on that folder. And so I went, well, maybe I can figure out if I wrote it, which I don't remember, if I did, I could figure out what song it was based on the melody, on the length of the melody line, you know, in the verses or something.
Yeah.
And he said, okay, well, and so I started with A, you know, and I played the A songs. No, nothing fits. Then B. And then C, then on and on until I got to M. And finally, here's the song, Man of the World, and it fit perfect to the... I said, oh, I wrote this. This is about, you know, people being, you know, welded to their damn cell phone.
Yeah.
And .com, and, you know? And so we found that song. And then so we had... we had seven, and then he said, well, let's write two more from scratch. And so we wrote Don't Pull the Trigger.
That's my favorite. I love it. And that.
Yeah, me too.
Oh my God.
So and good. Then we wrote Meant to Be Alone. And it's funny, he sent it was my wife, you know, Elizabeth, he sent me this, you know, text of the song. When you know, because that's how we do it. He'll write a melody or a acoustic kind of guitar version, and then he says, okay, this is how it is. This is a melody, and write lyrics to this, and then we'll go in the studio and we'll do the track. And so he sent me this, and Elizabeth said, that's so cool that, you know, what he says at the beginning there, he says, I can't really play this on guitar, but this is how it goes. And the chorus and verse. And she said, why don't you put that at the beginning of the actual recorded track? It was her idea. And I thought that was so cool. And I called and I said, Richard, what do you think about this idea? And he goes, it's awesome. I love that idea. And so we had, the guy that mixed the record is a guy named Matt Prock. He's a young guy from Chicago and he's really brilliant. And we called him up. I said, Matt, you know, I want to meld this demo on a text to the beginning of the actual song. And he figured out how to do it. So that, you know, the song starts with that little original text demo and goes into the actual track.
Oh, that's so cool. I love that. I love that so much. I hate the fact that we're out of time. I mean, you have been so much damn fun. I want to beg you to do a part two someday. It was just...
Well, you can. I could do a part two.
Dude.
You got talk to Tom.
I will. Berger. I will.
A lot of times I do that because people get involved and they, you know, we tell stories and then they want to know this and that, and then we're out of time.
Yeah.
Because I've got three today. I got 12:30, 1:30, 2:30. I've got another one at 2:30.
Yeah. Well, you got to go. But I want to tell you one quick thing before I let you go. I had tickets to see David Bowie in 1983.
Oh.
Then I found out you guys were playing the same day. So I bought tickets and gave my Bowie tickets away. And then I found out that the Tube show got canceled and I had to go buy Bowie tickets again. But here's the point. I go to the show at the Tacoma Dome. It's 20,000. There's 20,000 people. I waited all day. I was up front against the boards. When you guys came out, you did your businessman intro. You hit softballs out into the stadium. It was insane. I laughed so hard. I had so much fun. Bowie comes out, looks down at me, straight down at me, and I swear to God I was gay at that moment because I was like, oh my God, that is a beautiful man. I watched five songs, and I decided it's time to go home because I came for the Tubes, man. I walked out on Bowie because I had seen you. I came. The Tubes were enough, man. Fee Waybill was enough. And I wanted to tell you that story because to me, dude, it's like talking to you is like meeting Santa Claus. I mean, you're real. And I'm floored. So thank you so much. This has been bonkers great for me, and I can die at peace.
Oh, Rob, thank you very much, man. I that was a great tour, that 83 tour with Bowie. Oh, my, I mean, playing for, you know, 75,000 people every night.
Yeah.
It was unbelievable.
Yeah.
And he loved us. He even pushed back his set so that we could set up our whole set. I mean, he was so gracious. And then Peter Gabriel?
Yes.
Opening act?
Yes.
Oh, my God.
I want to talk about that next time because Peter, you and Peter, just I'll end on here. You and Peter are my two favorite artists of all time.
Rob, thank you, man.
Take care
of yourself.
You bet.
Okay. Bye.